Hi friends, we have already finished electrostatics, so now we are going to begin with magnetostatics. As the name suggests, magnetostatic means the magnetic field is constant. That is, the magnetic field does not change with time, and the source of magnetostatics, that is the source which is required to produce a magnetic field which is constant, is a steady current. A steady current is a current which is independent of time and flow is constant along that length of the wire. The magnetic force on a moving point charge Q in a magnetic field B is given by F is equal to Q, the charge Q, into V cross B. V is the velocity of that charge. And this force is also called as the Lorentz force. In the presence of both electric and magnetic field, the formula will become Q E plus V cross B. So this will then be written as Q V B sine theta, where theta is the angle between V and B. First case, let's consider that this theta value is equal to 0 or 180. That means the angle between V and B is 0 or 180. That is, when it is 0, then the velocities and B are in the same direction. When it is 180, then the velocity is upwards, then the magnetic field will be downwards. At that time, the net force acting on this charge Q will be sine 0 is 0 and sine 180 is also 0. That force will be equal to 0 and the path of the charge Q will be a straight line. Second case, if we had theta which is around 90 degrees or 270 degrees, that is, the angle between V and B is either 90 or 270, then the value of force will be equal to only Q, V and B, and the particle and this charge Q will move in a circular path. So the path will be circular path, and we know for circular path there is a centripetal force, that will be QVB is equal to MV square divided by, let's say the radius is equal to R. Let's say let this radius be R. From this we can write the momentum P is equal to QB into R. So this formula is also known as the cyclotron formula. And then the cyclotron frequency will be equal to omega, that is nothing but V by R. So that will be QB divided by M. Now time period of this circular or rotational motion, the time period is equal to 2 pi by omega. That will be equal to 2 pi M upon QB. The third case is when this angle theta is some angle other than 0, 90, 180 and 270. The third case is this theta is some other angle other than 0, 90, 180 and 270. Then what will happen? That is, let's say the velocity is along this direction and the magnetic field is along this direction, and this is some angle theta. Then we can resolve this velocity into two components. Let's call this direction as V perpendicular, that is the component of velocity perpendicular to the magnetic field, and let's call this direction as V parallel, that is component of velocity parallel to the magnetic field. Then this V parallel will be equal to V cos theta, and V perpendicular will be equal to V sine theta. In this case, the path will be a helical path. Helical path means it will go like this. This is the magnetic field which is along, the magnetic field is along this direction. So because of these two components of velocity, the path will be a helical path. Then the time period of this helical path is given by 2 pi r upon v perpendicular. We are going to consider the perpendicular component here, and that will be equal to 2 pi m upon q b. the pitch will be equal to P into V parallel component here. So the radius of this helical path, which is R, that will be equal to MV perpendicular upon QB. You have to remember where we are using the perpendicular component and where we are using the parallel component. Now let's consider a cycloid motion. This is the x-axis, this is the y-axis, and this is the z-axis. Let's say along the x-axis we are having a magnetic field B, along the z-axis we have the electric field E, and we have a positive charge Q at the origin. Now what will happen is, because of this, since this charge is at rest, there will be no magnetic force acting on it now. The only force which will be acting on it will be due to the electric field, and this electric field is upwards. That means what? It is moving from positive to negative. The charge will be attracted upwards. The charge will start moving upwards. But as the charge moves upwards, its velocity increases, and now the magnetic force starts acting on it. And because of the magnetic force, the path of this charge will curve out and it will start taking sort of a turn thing. Up to this point it is okay, but now what happens is the charge is moving downwards because of the magnetic field, but the electric field is in upward, the electric force is in upward direction. So the charge is now moving against the direction of this electric force, and because of this it slows down. It slows down and it comes to a stop again at the y-axis. When it stops here, again the magnetic force acting on it will become zero. There will be only electric force acting on it, and the electric force will bring the charge upwards. The same thing will happen as the charge will move upwards. Magnetic force will start acting on it, and that force will now tend to curve the path of the path. Sorry, curve the path of the particle, of this charged particle. As the path curves, it starts going against the direction of the electric force, and therefore it slows down and again stops at this point, which is at the y-axis. So the same thing will happen, and this process will continue on. This type of motion is known as the cycloid motion. So here we started with initial velocity, that is at time t equals to 0, the velocity was 0. The electric force we saw is equal to Q into E bar in the z hat direction, and the magnetic force which is acting on the charged particle is equal to Q V bar cross B bar. So the net force which is acting on it is equal to Q E bar plus V bar cross B bar. Now we can see the velocity of this particle is both along the z direction and the y direction. So I can write V as equal to Vy y hat plus Vz z hat. And the magnetic field B is only along the x hat direction. Some magnitude B and the direction is x hat direction. So what is V cross B now? V cross B will be equal to Vy y hat plus Vz z hat cross B x hat. For doing this, we'll consider the determinant x hat, y hat, z hat. In here we'll have 0, Vy, Vz, we'll have B, 0 and 0. Take the determinant, and this determinant will be equal to plus Vy B y hat minus, sorry, Vz B, and then Vy B z hat. So this force will now become Q, electric field along the z hat direction, electric field is along z hat direction, plus V cross B, that is Vz B y hat minus Vy B z hat. Now force F is equal to ma, that is equal to, again acceleration is d square x by dt square. So that will be equal to mx double dot, sorry, in y and z direction, right? So my double dot plus mz double dot. This is d squared y by dt square and d squared z by dt square. So my double dot y hat plus mz double dot z hat. Considering the y components, we'll have my double dot is equal to only the y components q vz into b, and we'll have mz double dot is equal to q e minus vy b. Now vz can be written as z dot and vy can be written as y dot. So what conclusion do we get from here? First, that the plane of the cycloid, because the cycloid motion is along this direction, so the plane of the cycloid is perpendicular to the magnetic field. Plane of the cycloid is perpendicular to the magnetic field. Second, the direction of motion of the center of the cycloid is along the y hat direction, and that y hat is nothing but E bar cross B bar. E is z and this is x, so z cross x will give us y. The speed of the center of the semicircle is equal to v of t at time t will be nothing but E bar upon B bar. And the frequency of rotation is equal to f is equal to qb upon 2 pi m. We will look at a problem now and you will understand it better. The question is as follows. A proton with a speed 300 meter per second in a circular orbit in the xy plane where magnetic field is equal to 1 tesla and the electric field is equal to 1 volt per meter. This is along the z hat direction and this is along the positive y direction. We have to find the speed and the direction of the center of the circular orbit. It is pretty easy. E is along y direction, B is along z direction. Let's plot it first. This is x, y and z. This here we are having electric field, along the z direction we are having the magnetic field, and our proton is moving in the xy plane, that it is in this plane. We have to find the direction and the speed of the center of that circular orbit. So we know that the direction of the motion of circular orbit is given by E bar cross B bar. E is along the y direction, B is along the z direction, and y cross z is x. So our circular, the center of the circular orbit is moving in the positive x direction. We need to find the speed, and that speed is given by E bar upon B bar. We saw the formulas just now, and that is equal to 1 by 1, that is nothing but 1 meter per second. So that is the speed of the center of the circular orbit, and this is the direction of the motion of the center of the circular orbit. It was easy, right? So now we have already done the magnetic force which is acting on all this. You have to remember one thing, that the magnetic force does no work. It may change the path of the particle, but it will neither accelerate it nor decelerate it. Let's say we have a wire with line charge lambda moving with velocity v along this wire. Then the current, or we can say line current density, will be equal to lambda into v bar. If we had a surface with surface charge density sigma which is moving with velocity v, then the surface current density will be equal to sigma into v bar. And if we had some three-dimensional volume with volume charge density rho, volume charges rho moving with velocity v, then the volume current density j bar will be equal to sigma into v bar. Now if lambda, sigma and rho are positive, then the current direction is in the direction of the velocity. So k equals to sigma v bar can also be written as I by length perpendicular. L perpendicular is the length which is perpendicular to the current flow. And j equals to sigma v bar can also be written as I by A perpendicular. A perpendicular is the area perpendicular to the current flow. Then the forces can be written as F will be equal to, we know F is equal to Q V cross B. This can also be written as integration dQ V cross B. Now we know dQ is equal to lambda dl, or it can be sigma dA, or it can be rho d tau. So now we have three forces. If we consider the line current density, then we have F is equal to integration over the curve C. We, instead of dQ, we'll have lambda dl. So we'll have lambda dl, we'll have V cross B. Lambda into V will be I. So integration over curve C, I dl cross B, with this B is vector and dl is also vector. So the direction of dl and the direction of current will be same. If we consider the surface current density, then the force will be equal to integration over the surface S. For dQ, we'll have sigma dA. So we'll have sigma dA into V cross B. Sigma into V is K. So that will be equal to integration K cross B dA. If we consider volume current density, then the force will be integration, this is surfaces over the volume V, J bar cross B bar into D tau. So these are the three forces. The force when we consider line current density, the force when we consider surface current density, the force when we consider volume current density, magnetic forces. Now, a convention is that when you consider cross, that means the magnetic field is going into the board, and when we consider dot, then the magnetic field is coming out of the board. We will end this part here. In the next part, we will look into Bio-Savart law. Peace be upon you.